Hi, here everybody. This is the workshop, curatorial workshop for Shanghai Biennale 2012. And the second part of the workshop has to do with curating the next edition of the Biennale. And here with us is the group of students from all around the world. And today we are happy to have Terry Smith. Professor Terry Smith has just finished his new publication, Thinking Contemporary Curating. And we have the honor to have him with us online to talk about his new book and also to give us some feedback about biennial curating. And the first session, Terry is going to give a presentation of his book and the ideas about curating and about curating Biennale. And the second part will be the Q&A process. So, Terry?
Okay. Well, my thanks to you, Man Ray, for inviting me to speak, and to Mr. Chu for his support of the whole event and for his very impressive diagram of the way in which Biennales fit into the world. I was interested to see his map, which I thought fitted very well on the map of China or maybe on the map of Shanghai. So I thank him very much. And I thank Sun Tian for coordinating. And I thank Annie Lai and Wu Shehao, I'm sorry for the pronunciation, for the technical assistance. And Jing Yuan Yuan for her assistance with translations and making everything happen. So in Pittsburgh, I thank my colleague, Professor Nancy Conde, who is director of the Global Studies Program. That's part of all this international studies that's behind me on the wall here. And Mr. Mark Vexel for his technical advice. So in the book, what I do is acknowledge all the many people who helped bring the book into being. Can you see the cover of the book there now?
Great. Yes.
Great. There's lots of launches, and I especially thank Chelsea Haynes and Mandy Saar and Renee Brock and Misa Jeffries, but especially Kate Fowle, who you're very lucky to have with you. She's got this amazing energy, as you've found out, and she helped help me write the book, really. It's the same energy that she puts into making ICI such a wonderful operation that it is. So what I'll do in these remarks, maybe in the next 45 minutes, is talk about the key questions that got me writing and give you a sense of the key ideas in each of the chapters. So these are the chapters. Now, I hope the students are not writing anything down, but just listening and looking, because you can keep the PowerPoint, and I believe you have a text that in English that you can look at, and I believe Xi and Zhao are translating. I should have thanked him as well for doing translating of the text. So then I'll also conclude with my kind of wish list for a truly contemporary kind of curator. And then we'll have a discussion. I look forward to discussion, because what I'd really like to do is take my ideas further than where they are now. So in the preface to the book, Kate spoke of the book as a kind of gift that I'm giving to curators, but it's really me trying to give something back, because I've always been impressed by the passion and the commitment that curators bring to their task. And we see something like that in the testimonial of a friend of mine who died very sadly a couple of years ago, and he wrote this curator's last will and testament. His name is Nick Waterlow. He was the curator of many Biennales, many Sydney Biennales during the 1980s and 90s, very important ones. He said the curator should have passion. The first thing a curator should have is passion. The second thing is a kind of eye of discernment, so a judgment of art. The third thing is you should be an empty vessel. Curator should be nothing. Art should come into the curator, he says. And a curator should have an ability to be uncertain, because to be certain before an exhibition is to already make up your mind, and there's no point in doing an exhibition if you know everything beforehand. You should believe in the necessity of art and artists. of course, that's absolutely basic. And you should be a medium. You should bring a passionate and informed understanding of works of art to audiences in ways that will stimulate, inspire, and question. And the last thing you should do is make possible the altering of perception. So I think he was a Jim Morrison Doors fan. That's why he wrote that, like that. Now, unfortunately, for family reasons, he was killed. It was very sad. And he wrote this just before he died, without knowing that he would die. So it's a very personal text, particularly for people from Australia like me. Anyway, so every exhibition demonstrates the curators reflect on circumstances, they wrestle with ideas, they develop research programs, they spark insights. But the discourse about curating, the kind of talk the curators have amongst themselves, I've noticed, very passionate and committed, but it's routinely satisfied with rhetorical gestures and knowing asides and ostensive demonstrations, like this is what curating is. It's, for a profession that's driven by the desire to communicate with art's publics, the enabling dialogue is surprisingly inner-directed, I think. So I ask myself, why is the substance of curatorial thinking so rarely articulated? And it seems to me that this question has surfaced and become public recently within a time of rapid and quickening change in the conditions within which curating is now undertaken. And these changes require a different kind of thinking than what served during the modern period. And that leads to a key question, which is on your screen. What is contemporary curatorial thought? So the main thing I try and do in chapter one is try and distinguish what is distinctive about each, about how curators think and about what they do, but also to identify what they share with other art world actors. So many of these questions came up the NOW Museum Conference, which Kate and Claire Bishop, who you see there, put together. And I'm showing you, as I speak, images of art historians and curators sitting together. And I try and distinguish in the book the things you do when you're an art historian and when you're a critic and when you're a curator. So let me try and summarise those very briefly. When you're an art historian, you're looking at an exhibition or a museum installation, you look through the exhibition, you're looking for fresh art historical facts, for something that will help you interpret more deeply or at least differently the historical formation of a school of art, the evolution of the work of an artist across a whole career, and hopefully you'll show some relationship to the society in which the artist works. That's what you do if you're an art historian. If you're an art critic, you write more about your immediate response to the works in the exhibition. You compare them to each other. You show how this artist in this work transformed form into figure. How the artist made figure come into being, if you like, in meaningful or sometimes not so meaningful ways, if you're being critical. But the point is, before any of this can occur, a curator has already examined the artworks and put them together in an exhibition. The curator comes before the critic and the art historian. The curator has looked at the works in a different way. Curators, I think, look at works of art not in and of themselves, not only the way in which an artist does, but curators look for the exhibitionary potential of a work of art. They look at works of art to select them for showing, usually in relation to others, at the point at which they become public. So curatorial thought, I think, is distinctive above all because it thinks and acts in terms of exhibitionary values. So what are exhibitionary values? And what kind of thinking goes into discerning them? So if you think about how a historian or a critic or a theorist thinks, what we do is search for a kind of conceptualization, meaning a mental image that encapsulates apparently diverse or disparate elements into a kind of shape, into what I call an idea. It's a discursive figure, a figure of discourse that holds up when it's explicated, when we think it through, when we write it out, when we contest it in debate, when we measure it against the works of art that it's describing. It has to work in detail. So if that's what historians and critics do, perhaps curatorial insight, curatorial thinking, maybe, is the kind of thinking that gathers up all the elements under consideration into a pre-visualized exhibition. Or more explicitly, it imagines or projects forward what a viewer might do as he or she journeys through an exhibition, moves through a number of works of art. And what's the likely accumulative response to looking at those works of art as you move through the exhibition? Historians look for historical movement away from the exhibition. Critics look for the work of art in relation to other works of art. Curators think about exhibitions and how they put together, how they move between works of art. Curators, if you like, think in terms of time and actual movement in time and space, whereas critics and historians think in terms of historical time or a moment of actual space. I'm adding to the text here, but I think this is an important point about different relationships between time and space. An exhibition is a different kind of way of organizing time and choosing a space than looking at one work of art or thinking about or writing a text. Anyway, many curators think about space in terms of one ideal viewer's pathway, but many others prioritize a number of possible routes for the viewer through this space, or the passage of numbers of viewers moving in parallel or in concert. So, for example, museum design has shifted, as we see in this case of the work by Sana, has shifted to a situation of encouraging people to move through many exhibitions inside a single museum and to move freely at their own pace and follow their own direction. So the exhibition, in this expanded, extended sense, works above all to shape the spectator's experience, take its visitor through a journey of understanding that unfolds as a guided yet open weave pattern of affective insights. I think each triggered by looking, it accumulates until the viewer has understood the curator's insight and hopefully arrived at insights previously unthought about by both and by the artist. New insights. So exhibitionary value is to generate new thought about art coming from that exhibition right there and then, not from the history of art in general or from art criticism. So of course these projective imaginings are modified in the planning, in the mounting, in the response to the exigencies of time and space and the persons involved. The how of selecting the artworks and the other materials and of mounting an exhibition as an arena of experience is as crucial as what it is and what is this for and why it is consequential. So how, what and why are all very important. But despite the reticence and pragmatism of many curators, the how does not substitute for the what or the why. Curatorial thinking is not only practical, it's praxeological in this sense. Okay, so that's a summary of chapter one. A few more to go. The second chapter really tries to look at the way in which exhibitions are located within a very large and elaborate infrastructure. It's the art infrastructure that I want to speak about. And that itself is something all curators obviously need to know about, have a sense of, not just the way it's laid out, but the way it's moving through historical time at present. So I call this the exhibitionary complex. It's like the exhibitionary city in Mr. Chu's diagram. So maybe I think, in fact, that diagram, that map, is in fact a map of infrastructure and how art works within it. Am I right? I think I'm right about that. Anyway, so I think about the first topic as a spectrum, an array, which ranges on the one side from the very traditional museum to the most recent, and from those most thoroughly invested in landmark and location to those that presume mobility and transient. So on the one hand, you have great museums like this, the Metropolitan Museum like Art, what we call a mothership amongst mega museums. We call this now mega museums. And it's like very few comparators, the British Museum in London, the Louvre in Paris. Recently, they've included contemporary art within their treasure troves and appointed specialist curators and collectors and tried to become a bit more contemporary as an experience of moving through through the kind of treasure box of the whole building. At the other end of the spectrum are open-ended curated projects, short or long-term, that seek to work within the creativity that's already present in the everyday life of small but constrained communities. So in Pittsburgh, we have an example of a place called the Waffle Shop, that's a community building, consciousness-raising location, performance space, TV studio, blog site, conceived and run by artists associated with Carnegie Mellon University, that offers waffles. In fact, it just recently closed down. It had a wonderful place, the Conflict Kitchen, where you could go and get takeaway food, but the food was the food produced by all the countries with which the United States was in conflict, only those countries. And it turns out that you have been the beneficiary of the closure. You in Shanghai have been the beneficiary of this because, of course, as you know, the Pittsburgh Pavilion in Shanghai is created by the same artist, by John Rubin, the artist who made the Waffle Shop and the Conflict Kitchen. And I don't have to know, it's great. I just found this out in the last few days, curated by Chelsea Hines from ICI. So it's a fantastic conjunction of Pittsburgh and Chelsea and your Biennale that's happening right here. It's fantastic. I think it's wonderful. And I congratulate you on having all these different cities producing their little moments of appearing within the Biennale as a whole. It's a terrific idea to shift the structure a little bit. And we're very pleased that a family very much like the Andy Warhol family, you get some sense of what their life was like in the city where I sit right now. Okay, so on one hand, you have Conflict Kitchen. On the other hand, you have the Metropolitan. What happens in between? Well, there's an enormous amount of stuff, and I've listed them in the text. There's period museums, national collections, there are geopolitical area civilization museums, there's a museum of the city, the university galleries, there's art school galleries, private collection museums, there's museums of modern art, contemporary art, single artist museums, there's painting museums or glass museums, whatever, spaces dedicated to large-scale commissions. In some cities, as well as these, there are venues that don't have collections but are devoted to changing exhibitions, particularly lots in Germany and some in Europe, Kunsthalle, alternative spaces, artist-operated initiatives, satellite spaces, foundations have exhibition venues some kind, and then research institutes, universities and other places have often temporary or longer exhibitions. So we've moved to a point where there are many emergent, what I call quasi-institutions, that shift away from the idea of physical location and on-site continuity towards situations in which the event or the image prevails over place or duration. Now, the spectrum is huge, and in some places, some cities have all of those things. In the curious way, become a kind of model towards which most cities and most countries aspire. In other words, everyone wants the whole exhibitionary infrastructure, and if you don't have it, you worry about it. But it's very important, I think, to think about this infrastructure as not something that's a series of static buildings or places that become more flexible at the other end. In fact, the infrastructure works because every one of these organizations and places was created in response to another one that was already there. And they're usually created in a way to be more critical or more flexible or more innovative than the one before. And what happens then is that the ones that are being, as it were, made more conservative by a new institution, they pick up ideas from the new institution. They often employ people from the institution, and the whole structure keeps energizing itself by taking ideas from all over itself. So what I do in the book and in some of my other books is trace the way in which exhibitionary ideas have shifted and changed in a whole series of museums. I haven't got time to go into the detail here, but we have a situation in the Museum of Modern Art, for example, in New York. If you compare the late modern galleries up the top of the screen with the contemporary galleries down the bottom, and allow for the fact that contemporary galleries are twice as high, in fact, sometimes three times as high as the other ones, there's actually not much difference when you walk around the building. Even though the art is actually fundamentally different, the way in which the Museum of Modern Art treats it is really not very different. For example, they can't hardly ever cope with anything like a black box. They can't do media art. They want everything to look like a modern painting or sculpture in one way or another. So you've got a museum that's kind of reaching out. And here's another thing maybe we could discuss. I've recently discovered that one of the key challenges facing the Museum of Modern Art is that there's too many people wanting to visit it. Imagine that, too many people wanting to come into your museum. To such an extent, the museum is so full of people that they're now trying to conceive what would the Museum of Modern Art be like if it was an online experience for people who never came to the museum. Okay, so there's the infrastructure that we're speaking about, and I only mentioned this a few times in the book, but the more I think about it, it's obvious that we're going to have an art infrastructure that is virtual almost to the extent that it is material as time goes on, at least in some places that lots of people really want to go to. Anyway, we can maybe talk about that. So I've spoken about kinds of I'll just show you a few more. Other museums like Tate Modern try and make their collection of modern try and bring it up to date by putting contemporary art next to it. They frame their collection of modern art by what I call contemporizing it. Contemporizing is like, you know, making something contemporary. The other solution is to produce museums that are as interesting as artworks as the work within them. For example, it's not just a spectacular place to go. This is the biggest contemporary sculpture produced in the late 20th century, this building right here. And anything that you put inside it battles against it. It's a different kind of thing. But that's another solution to the kind of situation that we're in, becoming less and less attractive to people to spectacularize the experience. But spectacularizing the experience is something that even artists now are showing. For example, Carlton Holler, in his recent exhibition at the new museum, which turned it into basically a fun fair. It was meant to be a commentary on fun fair, but it really was itself a kind of fun fair. So we're reaching a point in some circumstances where the kind of spectacularization of everyday life is filling our museums and galleries. And in some ways, as I'm sure Boris has pointed that to you often, is hardly distinguishable from the kind of spectacularizing and image-making practices of everyday life itself. So that's the kind of spectrum in terms of fixed buildings and then the variations on them. But there's a third element that's really crucial in this whole infrastructure that's to do with time. The exhibition, as I said, is about space and time. And the Biennale, the biennial, which we'll talk about a lot later on, I hope, to me is a fascinating thing because, in effect, the biennial is a mini version of a museum, or at least one or two exhibition spaces in a museum, that is repeated every 2 or 3 years in a place usually that doesn't have large museums or big infrastructure and so on. The whole history and the success of the biennial over time has only worked because it happens occasionally and the rest of the art world in that particular city doesn't have to deal with such intensity for 18 months. I only have to deal with it for 4 or 5 months. But it will come back again, and it will be something like that in 2 years' time. So it's a kind of change you can always be ready for and look for. So I'll be fascinated to hear your comments on that. But that, of course, has changed over time in a massive way. And that'd be interesting to talk about, I think. So we're now in a situation, as we saw in this work by Stuart Smith and Bert Lintman and Robert Petrushko, it's called Transactions, this work. It was at the the show at ZKM. And what it did was map the occurrence of biennales. Here we see, of course, 1984, which was, of course, Havana Biennale. But then the number of biennales around the world that occurred by 2009, there's so many that you can't actually fit them on this background screen. So the biennial, I think, is becoming part of a structural form. So logically, we can put it in between concrete institutions such as museums and supplementary ones such as Kunsthalle or online sites. And indeed, biennials have evolved into internally diverse displays that occasionally but regularly spread themselves out across the range of exhibitionary venues of a city that hosts them, that occupy each site, that make each site different from what it normally is, also connecting them for the duration of the exhibition. But in another sense, as I'm sure you're all studying very closely, the exhibitionary format is a global one because all biennials are intensely connected to each other. So in that sense, even though they happen only, they are in fact happening all the time in a connected sense around the world. So in that sense, they're structural. And indeed, they've become fundamental to the display of contemporary art. So fundamental that many biennials are taking on the role that museums used to take, which is to show us art from the past. And I call them holes in time, holes in contemporary time that shoot us back to the 30s or the 60s or somewhere that the curator thinks is relevant to the present. Anyway, so on a more theoretical level, the infrastructural array might therefore be seen as concentrating its energies into three realms. On the one hand, the institutional. On the other hand, the alternative or the supplement. And thirdly, the link between them. And these are the forms taken by its urge to territorialise. But at the same time, there's an incessant urge on the part of each type of venue and each exhibition format to imitate the vital practices of the others, to absorb some of their remaining energies in the case of institutions, to counter them with previously unimagined activity in the case of the alternatives, and to embody projective versions of both in the case of the biennial. So to fully grasp the settings in which curating is done, we have to keep in mind the interplay between the art system, which moves slowly that yet constantly regenerates its structures, and the fast movement of the artwork and exhibitionary ideas. So that leads me to think that we've come to a point in which the museum is no longer the limit setter, not even the default for contemporary art and contemporary curating. Biennials have become the major vehicles of contemporary art, but their success has brought some problems for curators, who are their primary custodians. It's not least the challenge of constant reinvention. So since the year 2000, the biennial has been widely seen as being in a crisis of overproduction, of having become stale in form, and as a result, in danger of being absorbed back into the traditional museum. And amongst the curatoria, the brilliant curators of exhibitions like the people in this room, over there, your room, not this room. This is the curatorium. There seems to have risen a competition as to who could reconceive the biennial in the most influential way. But if we take a global view of this situation, there's a bigger issue than that. I mean, to have to reinvent the biennial every time you do one means you reinvent the form 100 times a year at the moment. That's impossible. It's not possible. Anyway, if we take a larger view, the bigger issue is the shifting of the entire exhibitionary complex towards more volatile forms and formats. And what's emerging as a major activity for artists and curators today, a kind of infrastructural activism, I call it. So I think the infrastructural is rapidly replacing the curatorial as the problem to be grasped, the issue to which attention must be paid and upon which energy must be expended. Let's talk about that a little bit more, if we could. But before we can clearly see how this issue is being tackled, we've got to look at one or two other questions, particularly the delicate dance between two symbolic figures, artists as curators and curators as artists. So there's a whole chapter on this this fascinating question. So despite the recent and rightful celebration of a few maverick curators such as Harold Zeman, Renard Bloch, Pontus Fulton, Jensen McShine, and a few maverick critics such as Lucy Lepard, who staged path-breaking shows during the years around 1970, the historical record shows that radical exhibition practiced by curators was preceded and until recently dramatically outmatched by the work of certain artists who reimagined ways of making exhibitions. They did anti-exhibitions. They substituted one kind of public display space for another, including transpositions of non-museum spaces into the museum and vice versa. Many of these experiments have survived as models for curatorial practice, including particularly recently, and they serve as go-to inspiration. So just a few examples. Bruder's, his way of gathering a whole series of objects into a museum of modern art, as were dedicated to the eagle or objects with eagles in them, and he found kind of substitute museum in the years 1968, the years after the insurrections and transformations of 1968. Hans Harker, this is just one of his visitor profiles, developing what became called institutional critique, but certainly wasn't called that by him. That was a tax on the corruptions of institutions, their embedment, museums, their embedment in high capitalism, in international war machinery, and so on and so forth. Nothing as mild as institutional critique, much more radical than that. Joseph Kosuth, his way of thinking about exhibitions, when he and Hans and others got the chance to put on exhibitions within museums of their work, they often said, well, I'd rather rehang the museum in a particular way. In this case, the Play of the Unmentionable, Joseph really did a survey of censorship of the visual arts over time, using the museum collection to bring that out. Influencing thereby a lot of curators subsequently, such as the curator of Magicians Del Tour, Jean-Hubert Matin, for example. Very famous case is Fred Wilson, his reinstallation of the Maryland Historical Society, mining the museum. It's really important to remember that Fred was both an artist and a museum educator. He was a curator of education at the time. He put together a rethinking of the museum, bringing all the material about the exploitation of African Americans out forward into the museum. So institutional critique really takes shape in the work of someone like Andrea Fraser, for example, who takes the elements of how a museum's organised, in this case, the gallery talk, and transforms into this absolutely crazy performance. In this case, she's doing it in the cafe of the museum in Philadelphia. So I think that's led, as she points out, it's led to a kind of institutionalization of critique as art. But what does it do for curators? So in a certain sense, I'll go back for a second. It puts curators in the position of moving from critical curating to the curating of critique. Something to really think about is that as a critical form of curating itself becomes institutionalized, the same thing could happen as happened to radical artists, anti-museum artists, that turned their work into an absorbed form of museum art. It's a paradox, although obviously curators are one step away from being artists on my overall model. So that's worth thinking about. Okay, just a couple of examples of other modes of exhibiting that artists insisted upon that have influenced the display of their work or the work of similar artists and become, in fact, curatorial models subsequently. Clearly, the great practice of Donald Judge, a very clear practice, which I call remodelism, a kind of remodelist practice. Many of the relational aesthetics artists have become interested in languages of visual display. There's kind of display used not only in museum settings but in commercial settings, elsewhere in capitalist culture. And they've in fact, it's become a situation where for many artists, exhibitions have become their medium, a medium equivalent to paint and to space. The exhibition itself becomes the medium of an artist like Lynn Gilley. Very few curators, I think, have matched artists as inventors of new modes of curating since the 60s. Some have picked up on what artists do. For example, Jean-Hubert Martin in Magicians, as I mentioned before, he's a leading figure in a kind of very ahistorical way of thinking about artistic ideas in formation. Thinking about museum spaces as if they were studios or as if they were staging places for artistic ideas that were just in formation. Or indeed if they were museums from another time or place that have just landed in the present. And so that's another kind of resonance that he is an example of someone who develops things and moves in that way. And in a way, that's a background to the current documentum in a curious fashion that we could talk about in discussion as well, if you like. Okay, a couple more chapters and then I'll finish talking and then we can have our discussion. So the fourth chapter is about curating contemporaneity. So to me, I've argued in a number of my recent books that what I call contemporaneity, which really is the coexistence of difference, a different kind of difference, different ways of being in the world at the same time as others, but being in that world differently, being aware of difference, and able to negotiate difference, and at the same time be very aware that there's not one overriding idea, such as progress or historical inevitability, that will, way beyond our control, shape those differences and move them forward. We're now moving to a situation, there's so much difference in the world that proliferation of difference is what's really going on just about everywhere. So in a certain sense, you could argue that contemporaneity, as I've just described it, is more powerful than historical determination as the definer of contemporary life. It's therefore a sign that we're no longer wholly modern. But the curious paradox is that these qualities of contemporaneity are not confined to the present. And their current forms just simply can't be back projected. Specific kinds of ways of experiencing time differently have been present since the dawn of human consciousness. And that needs to be identified by historians and critics, and indeed, I think, curators and artists. In other words, to show what I call co-temporality, the coexistence of different temporalities at the same time. It's really infusing a lot of our practice and a lot of curatorial thinking, I think. And I quote Yao Rivas, who's been there, I know, with you, and he was thinking about Giorgio Agamben, made the comment that, and I quote him, "It's a fundamental necessity of curating to situate itself within those contemporaneities that remain in darkness, unserialized and unlived." So it's a very big challenge to curators now. Okay, but I think we can also say that something like this is being done by curators all the way across the exhibitionary spectrum. The focus is mainly on periods that immediately precede the present, yet are not yet distant past, but are still relevant to present possibility. So I talk of many exhibitions in detail, particularly some feminist shows such as Gender Check. This relates to Central Europe. There's great image there, Gender Check. And there are alternative critical modernities being looked at and pursued all over the world, both by curators, such as Simon Ajami and Dave Elliott and all the people who have worked on Africa Remix, but also by artists. So artists working in places where there is a lack of infrastructure, create works of art that operate as works of art, but also as informational infrastructure about, in this case, contemporary Africa. Okay. So the final chapter is about curatorial practice now. And what I do is pick out a series of themes about curatorial practice. And I'll just give you those themes with an example. Or two as we go along. One of them that I don't have an illustration for, but you can pick it up when I describe it, is about historicizing curating. So to establish, and I think I'm hearing a microphone move that's making a big noise.
It's not quite moving.
Something's moving on the surface of the table. It's making a big noise. Okay, so a set of current concerns, key things about curating right now. The first thing that's going on is that many curators are interested in historicizing curating to try and establish an independent history of curating, which is a great thing, I think. But it might also help to identify what is traditional and modern and contemporary about curating. And of course, we'd expect curating to remain closely aligned with the interests of artists and historians and critics and audiences, museums, collectors, galleries, publicists. But if curating had its own history and a separate way of developing, it would no longer be subservient to them, which it is in many cases. So current thinking about the history of curating seems to switch back and forth between the history of exhibitions, that's mainly done by art historians, and the history of curating, that's mainly done by Hans Ulrich Obrist in his books. So that's one thing. Another concern is what I call recuration. And lots of curators seem to be interested in repeating exhibitionary moments from the past. For example, Boris, as you all know, was involved in the Venice Biennale, in which he recreated works by Andrei Monstersky, particularly some that went back to the late 70s. And there's a picture of Boris there you can see on the screen, second from the left, in 1979. If you want to know what he looked like a few years ago, that's what he looked like. This is a kind of recurating, repeating an exhibition to explore not only what happened at the time, but what could be suggested about current practice. Another example is Palle Nielsen's famous exhibition at the Moderne Messe, which a whole space was made open to children to interact and just have a space dominant by the children themselves. And currently there's an effort to rethink that and refigure it. At the moment, it's only at the level of discussion, but they're trying to work out how an operation like that could be revisited and be recurated. And the parallel, obviously, is to the kind of practice of performance that we see in the work of, for example, Marina Abramovich, in which the Museum of Modern Art a couple of years ago re-performed a number of her works, and then she did a version of a work that she actually did in Sydney in 1981, which I saw when she was working with Boulay. But in this case, she made it a work that was open for anyone to sit opposite her for the entire day without moving. So that is a re-performance of an earlier work that became a kind of, in terms of the Museum of Modern Art, a kind of re-curating of performance. And it's, I think, very interesting. I'll just make a comment to the side. The Museum of Modern Art in New York has been very unsuccessful at showing critical performance work from the 70s onwards that wasn't painting or sculpture or an easily absorbable installation of some kind or another. It's left most of that stuff out. What it's doing by its program of re-performing performance art is adding in to the museum 40 years of work that they don't collect and haven't shown, but as performance. They still haven't worked out ways of showing all the other art that they left out, but at least they're working out a way of doing this, I think. So that's an example of an institution taking hold of a new curatorial tendency, showing it as a kind of art practice to keep itself going. Another imperative is to innovate within exhibition practice every time. And Obrist was very clear about this. For example, Cities on the Move, it showed in half a dozen different places, and every time they had an architect redesign the display. He said, Caspar Koenig taught me to think about architecture, and Richard Hamilton taught me that when you do an exhibition, if it doesn't invent a new display feature, it's doomed to oblivion. So here's the thing. Maybe not a whole exhibition, but there's a tendency on the part of curators to, what can I do that's a different kind of exhibitionary display within my show? At least one thing I'll do differently than anyone else has done. And that's become a kind of imperative, which is fine. I'm making a kind of record of these things that are changing. So the thing is to reimagine museums. How do you reimagine a museum? Bringing all these ideas of transformation and change into the actual bricks and mortar of a museum. So Charles Escher at the Van Abbey Museum thinks the 21st century art museum should be, I quote, something close to a mix of a part community centre, part laboratory, part academy, alongside the established showroom function, that encourages disagreement, incoherence, uncertainty and unpredictable results. So with Annie Fletcher, a team of collaborators realised this idea through a project 2009 called Becoming Dutch, and then further versions of it, as you see here, where this artist curated in effect a series of objects from his own life and history, giving a different sense of what a section in the museum could look like. And similarly, the Russian group has to be done, Chota Dilet, produced this activist club, which is kind of drop-in museum, that drops into the museum as a whole, drop-in exhibition that's taken away after a while. They call them plug-in exhibitions. So reimagining the museum, in effect these days, has been to bring in all the alternative, supplementary and biennial type ideas into the museum itself to make the museum more contemporary. And so that effort is being made. Another one is to co-curate with artists. So the highly visible, self-aggrandizing curator as artist model, as like Zeman, for example, so no longer imitate the artist, but co-curate with artists, as if curating was an artistic practice, just like art practice. Here's an example of Martha Rosa working with Anton Fedotov at the Fraction. He's been there and spoken to you about it, so you know all about what he's up to. It's a relationship that's close to the model of that between the film director and producer on the set of a movie, particularly independent. We're not talking big scale movies here. We're talking the independent producer of small scale independent movies. And that's the sort of model that's from. Finally, or close to the end, engaged or activist curating is really becoming very important. I understand Noto Thompson's been there, and he's obviously talked about living as form, recent history of radical art. So creative time as a curatorial project takes its cues from this tradition. And I think it's been a kind of interesting debate between Noto's perspective and Claire Bishop's insistence that socially engaged art must count as art. As much as it does ethical action or curatorial intervention. So I agree with that. But the curating, which is the primary practice of making art public, is closer to audience values in this regard than artist values, I think, or even activist values. So participatory form isn't essentially groundwork, but it doesn't guarantee exhibitionary value. So it's like obvious comment, you know, collaboration is the answer, but what's the question? I mean, the question has to be a question of consequence. Otherwise, collaboration is just being nice. What counts in these particular circumstances as radical exhibition making, and how does exhibition reform advance the social cause? Not just how does this work of art do it, but how does exhibition reform do it? That would be the question. So, again, an image I'm sure you've seen from Creative Time when it was in the Essex Street markets. And now it's travelling through the auspices of ICI as a nomadic show. So it's the exhibition, This Is What Democracy Looks Like, which was at the Gallatin Galleries in October, November 2001. The space that you're looking at, this gentleman was looking at a space, and behind him, just about 10 feet behind him, is a great big window onto the street. So the space is a rectangular, long, narrow space with a window on one side and this wall on the other side. And what the curator there did was invite anyone who was at Zuccotti Park to bring along their posters and so on and put them up. Video streams came from the park, became one of the meeting places for Occupy. And in effect, the theatre of the streets entered the gallery, occupied the gallery. And the curator stepped back, no judgment whatsoever, left it open for the gallery to be occupied in that sense. So there you had activism and a gallery being perfectly together in that space. So the last thing in this group, is curating contemporaneity, past, present, and future. So how does the challenge of curating contemporaneity, this multiple ways of being in time that I spoke about, look when we place it amongst the impulses driving curating now? And, you know, Kate knows this, but I was just finishing the book and I was writing about, wouldn't it be wonderful for at least one curator to show in the exhibition the processes of their curatorial thinking in the exhibition itself? Make an exhibition that show your mind working and you're thinking about to show in the exhibition. And then, of course, I go to documentary, and the main space in the rotunda shows Carol and Christophe Bacafia's, as she calls it, her brain. And this is the works for her, the core of the exhibition. And I'm happy to talk about it in more detail later, but I'll just make the comment now that if this is the brain, this is the head of the whole body, the exhibition becomes a kind of body across all its sites, therefore. So the body is spread through all the 20 or so buildings in which Documenta exists in Castle. And therefore the spectators become a kind of circulatory system moving around the body, like blood around the body. And the works on display become not the curator's ideas, because she boasted of having no idea. There's no idea in this exhibition. They actually become manifestations of the drives inhabiting her unconscious. The works become as if they surface from the unconscious of the exhibition. I think that's an interesting thing to talk about, think about in our discussion. So finally, I speak right at the very end about the what I call the infrastructure. What does that mean? Well, can we give some content to that sort of idea? And at Guangzhou this year, as you know, the curators who I think for the first time, no, because how, when, where is when, what, when, and where is a group of women. So anyway, 9 women curators decided to exhibit the contemporary art system itself. The diagram that they produced early on and then dropped, but it's kind of, I thought, a very interesting diagram. It's kind of thought balloons. So thought balloons, I'm sure many of you have drawn. This is a much less interesting diagram than the one that Mr. Chu produced, because he actually put it in the world and put factories and cities and countryside and lots of energy in it. But here, these are all abstract categories of people who are meant to be talking to each other. To me, not, well, you know, okay, it's a diagram, but it doesn't have much critical depth. So what I tried to do was conclude the book by asking, and I'll finish now in 1 minute, what is contemporary curatorial thought? And so I ended by listing a series of what I call constituents of contemporary curatorial thought as a way of summarizing what I've tried to cover in the book. And these, you know, these are things that I list not as a curator speaking, because as I explained, I've only curated 4 or 5 exhibitions and I've been on the planet for a long while, and many other people have curated many more, so I'm not a professional curator. But I have noticed that if I was a curator and I had to write a set of instructions to myself nowadays, this is what I write. So exhibit artwork, right? The work of art wants to be exhibited. Take away its inhibitions, bring it out. Renounce reticence, don't disappear behind your exhibition. Okay. Curate reflexively. Think about what one does, make one's thinking clear. Build research capacity so you can do better exhibitions. Articulate curatorial thinking. Archive the achievements of curators of exhibitions. Don't just stop when the work is put on the wall. Record your own responses to it. Discuss it with other people. Write them down. Share them with other curators. Publish them. As well as make better exhibitions out of them. Reinvent exhibition formats. Yes, that has to be done always. Turn the exhibitionary complex. That's what I mean by keep transforming this great complex that I've been speaking about. Proliferate alternative exhibitionary venues. Keep changing the places in which art can be shown. Activate the whole infrastructure and embrace spectatorship. And above all, I mean, it's the final summary thing, curate contemporaneity and art and society, past, present and future, critically. So I thank you for listening to me and looking at those images for so long. And we'll just end up reminding you about this book. That's what it looks like. I hope you get a chance to read it and discuss it. So now we'll turn off the imagery and we can talk to each other. No, I can't hear them. Okay, so unfortunately we've lost sound. Can you hear me still? Wave if you can.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Wait,
oh, now I can hear you. Okay, that's fine. Yeah. Okay, can you hear me? And can you speak, please, Matt Ray?
Yes.
Great,
yeah,
okay. You.
Yeah, good. Yes. Yeah, thank you, Terry, for such a great summary presentation for the new book. And here, I think I would take advantage of my position as the moderator of this talk and ask you some questions first, and after that, I'll take more questions from the floor here. And I found this book very timely, and it has a very fair, extensive coverage of aspects of contemporary curating. And but I also found the book roughly presumes that the challenges of the three currents that you mentioned, three currents of contemporary art, in contemporary curating are structured around exhibitionary complex. However, it seems to me that the real challenge comes from the third current, which, as far as I understand, consists of diverse of entities. Now, anti-institution, anti-establishments, anti-capitalism, anti-neoliberalism, the list can go on. And also, it also consists of diverse grassroots practices, whether it's artistic or non-artistic. Most of the third current is non-exhibitionary, either because it is not exhibitable or because it's anti-exhibition per se. So it seems you need to kind of look upon this presumption and then think of what the challenge, or how we understand the challenge of the currents of contemporary art. And in my second question, I also believe that the revision of exhibitionary complex needs also start with the challenges offered by the by the third current. And for example, what is the purpose of exhibition? And exhibition has to do with making things public. What kind of public formation is it? And what mechanisms, institutional or non-institutional mechanism, can it use? And what is the relationship between exhibition and other public spheres, and so on. So here are basically my very broad questions to you.
Well, let's try and work on them, particularly the three currents. So in my talk, I didn't speak much about them. I'm not sure if everyone in the room has read my What is Contemporary Art book. I wonder if they have. Maybe not. Some have. Let me spend a moment, maybe a couple of minutes, talking about the three currents and how they relate to exhibitions, how I understand that. Okay. Mm-hmm. So what I do in my other books is try and speak about the I try and get away from the idea that contemporary art is just what anybody is doing now, and that's doesn't mean anything. Or it's all one kind of thing, one kind of art. Because whatever you decide that one kind of art will be, you're going to be excluding enormous amounts of actual art. So what I've noticed around the world, and it's a very general thing, but it reflects the changes in geopolitical shifts and changes over the past 30 or 40 years. So what I discern are these three great currents in contemporary art that move through time at a different kind of rate. And the first one is a kind of cluster that I speak about as remodernism, or continuing from modernism, and focusing and being very focusing around the spectacularization of art. And that's clearly a way of thinking about art and a way of exhibiting art and creating great museums and spectacular places that follows the great developments of modern European culture, modern American art, all the efforts to modernize around the world, creation of spectacular architecture, great city centers, and so on and so forth. And what all of that does, it's got enormous energy, it's got great power, it's often called globalization in recent times. What all that does is does create an exhibitionary relationship between those with power and those without. It turns all of us into consumers of spectacle, of spectators of spectacle, if you like. And it can do it in highly refined ways, and some really wonderful art can be produced within it. That's what it is. So the exhibitionary structures that I speak about at the Museum of Modern Art and so on are not just old-fashioned or bricks and mortar or very expensive. They actually entail a certain kind of exhibiting and a certain kind of curating to work for them and work within them. So that's current number one. The second current is the energy that comes from decolonization, the end of the system of colonization, the development of countries in Asia like China who have developed their own way of being in the world in the last couple of decades. Enormous economic, social, cultural power in China, in Brazil, in India, many different places in the world. And that's led and quite literally produced an art that's not of the same type as the art that's produced in the first current, has not produced the same kind of exhibitionary museum-type infrastructure, although there's things shared in common with it. It's not the same kind, it's not heading in the same direction, has different purposes. It's often very national in purpose or very regional in purpose. It's not necessarily universal or to do with the history of art or modernism. So, and in fact, I would say that the biennales or biennials are the perfect exhibition form to connect the second current to the first. Okay, and that's why they've been so successful. They've allowed the art of the decolonizing countries and the curating and the exhibiting within those countries to connect with kind of exhibiting and curating in the dominant modern cultures. And that has meant that very often there's been an effort to absorb the artists and the thinking of curators by the dominant cultures. But on the other hand, what's been maintained in major exhibitions, you know, like Documentary 11 and a number of exhibitions throughout the world, is a critical and often subversive relationship to that dominant thing. So, and also, as I said before, biennials are terrific because they connect the world laterally. They don't just connect the south to the north, they connect east, west, and the history of the Havana Biennale is a magnificent history that actually innovates exhibition practice before most of the European ones, from 1986, particularly 1989 onwards. So we've got all those things. Now, when it comes to my third current, to explain it, if I can, clearly, it's not just about relational aesthetics and so on. You know, it's not just a tendency within art. It's all the kind of stuff that Boris talks about. It's about the social embeddedment of new media, of restructuring yourself across a much more dispersive cultural domains. Many elements of the third current are very conservative and very much to do with, you know, being a subject of Google or Apple or so on. It's not all broken and pure, inventive and critical, because also it's connected with elements of the first two currents. But because it tends to operate at a smaller scale, and because it tends to operate by people who are now in their 30s and 40s, connecting with each other and doing their own thing on a much lower scale basis, because it's networked much more laterally and so on and so forth, therefore, it doesn't need the classic exhibition reforms. So you're absolutely right by bringing this up. It doesn't need the big scale, you know, museum exhibition. Doesn't work there. Whenever it's included within a great museum, it fails. It just looks ridiculous. It doesn't work so well in biennials or biennales as well. So much of this material is not curated into those shows, unless there's some effort to try and do it. For example, like you just did, that the Pittsburgh work by John Rubin, which makes a lot of sense in Pittsburgh because it's entirely local conflict kitchen. It can give you, if you like, a kind of museumized version of it for the time of the Shanghai Biennale, just so you can get, a time capsule sense of what it's like. But you see, that goes back to my point before. This is a hole in time. you know, he's created a history of this family in terms of their rooms and where they live. The family's gone, but that's their room. And then he has a very good sense to say, it's not just a museum space, it's not just something like a natural history museum. We're going to sell all the works or give them away. So by the time the exhibition's finished, it's gone. And that's really important. If you hadn't done the second thing, the work would not be an interesting work. You had to do both for it to be interesting, I believe. So it enters your Biennale, but it goes away from it. It leaves it as well. And so maybe something like that, it won't work in every case. So nothing is a rule that's going to work in every case. But something like that is an exhibitionary act from, if you like, the third current to the second current. Because Biennales, even the Shanghai Biennale, is in that, is a practice within that second current I speak about. It's not a third current project, per se, I don't think. So, does that make sense, Man Ray, as a set of answers to your first question?
Yeah, perhaps the understanding of the definition of the third current can be quite different, you know, so far as I understand it, because it consists of the very diverse practices that usually cannot go into exhibition, go into museum, or the what we see as you know, how to exhibit, or that's you know, is the exhibition value the most important concern for, you know, curating on this type. My answer is it's not, because, you know, normally you just go in the field and do things, yeah, in the art field or non-art field to do things. And also it has to do with a particular type. Maybe you also mentioned that also, you know, infrastructural activism to fix the machine. The artistic machine to maybe, you know, as a channel for social change. Social change, you know, to a better artistic practice or better society. And this is a part that has nothing to do with exhibition at all.
Not with exhibitions as events that start on a certain date, finish on a certain date, and go in one place.
Right.
But clearly, the third current's only been around for 10 years. The first current's been around for centuries. The second current has been around since the 1950s. So it's really important to think about movement in historical time. So it's just kind of beginning. And I was just trying to think of other examples as you were speaking, where, in effect, the sensibility from a third current enters into, if you like, a first current space. So at Documenta, for example, in one of the streets away from the main venues, there's a house, or was an old building that used to be a hostel for Protestants in the 17th and 18th centuries, when Protestants in that part of Germany were being persecuted by Catholic majority. And that house is now not working, but Tiesta Gates, the artist who works in England and the States, who's a black artist who is also a musician, but a wonderful kind of builder and a constructor. So he and a group of his collaborators worked throughout Documenta, rebuilding the interior of this house and transforming each of the spaces into not just living spaces, but performance spaces. And in a very strange way, making many works of art out of the junk and the housing stuff that was just there. So it was a kind of long-term, slow, it was exhibitionary, it wasn't one exhibition, but it was kind of, it had the exhibitionary character, and people lived inside the exhibition, in effect. So you had that. That's one kind of transformation. And then, of course, just around the corner from that, there was a wonderful room with no signs that you entered into darkness, and slowly you found there were people moving in this space, and they they've developed a kind of performance dance that kept running between the people who were visiting that space without touching them. But none of this had enormous power. And of course, this is run by Tino Segarra, as we would know, but it wasn't signified as such. So that, to me, was an example of someone trying to imagine these holes in time, you know, that I speak about. That didn't have any particular form. You could hardly see the form, but it just took you out of time. That's not necessarily a third current thing to do, but I'm just trying to think of examples of a tendency now in curating that's just beginning, just taking shape now, you know, as we do our work. I think it's really amazing. Potential is fantastic. Anyway.
Okay. I think I should go back and, you know, work on, you know, reading this Paris contemporary art and, you know, do some of your work and write your feedback. I think we should, our audience here to see if they have questions.
Okay, yeah, love to respond.
Yeah. Could you come over? Yeah, I think, you know, we ask the student who want to ask me over here.
Thank you. Okay.
Yeah, thank you. Mm-hmm. Hi there. Thank you for the presentation. I have a two-part question. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, fine.
Okay, so the first question is, what is the relationship between the contemporary and the anachronistic? Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, got that.
Okay, so the second question is, can contemporary curating be interpreted as the making public or making visible of anachronistic moments of history? If so, what is the contemporaneity created in this process?
Well, I'm listening. What is the contemporaneity?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So, okay.
Sorry,
these are really good questions.
Yep. Maybe we could have the question again so we can understand it at this end.
Okay, I'll read it again.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. First question is, what is the relationship between the contemporary and the anachronistic? That's the first one. Second question, can contemporary curating be interpreted as the making public or making visible of the anachronistic moments of history? If so, what is the contemporaneity created in this process?
Well, okay, you can tell that Xiao is a philosopher. And is that, now these are quite profound questions. Let me try the first one. So,
okay, yeah, maybe the first. Yeah, and
the
anachronistic.
Yeah. Contemporary and anachronistic. Okay, so anachronistic to me is much less strong a word or much less strong a concept, much less rich concept than what's within the idea of the contemporary. Yeah, to be anachronistic is to be out of time, or out of date, or not fitting in a particular time, right? Maybe the one we're in, right? So it's fairly neutral as a description. It presumes that time and that ordinary thinking about time prevails, right? Common sense thinking about time, or standard social thinking about time, or orthodox philosophical think about time is, you know, a thing can be either contemporary or anachronistic in those terms. It's, so to me, that's relatively uninteresting. It just, if something's anachronistic, it's out of date, it doesn't fit, so what? That makes it in some sense weaker or less interest maybe, you can make a judgment, you know, because you've got to do something with this distinction if you want to maintain it. To me, contemporary, as I've tried to explain it, for most people means just to be up to date, to be of the present. And often the word contemporaneity means the quality of being up to date or of the present. And that's all it means. But again, to me, that's weak thinking about the issue. Much more interesting thinking is to take contemporary to mean to be with time, contempus, to be with time at the same time as others, to be in the same time, but to be in that time differently, which is what we are now. I mean, you and I are not contemporaries in some, but we are in others. So there's simple senses in which we're contemporaries and not contemporaries. But what we've been talking, I mean, all the exhibitions we've been talking about and all the artists we've been discussing, more and more artists, I mean, for example, a documenter, something like more than half of the artists made works about not just anachronism, but different ways of being in time differently, at the same time as others. So you constantly had works that shifted us, not just from the present to the past. When we went back to the past, we became aware that there were different ways of being in time in the past, and that was interesting. That was what was interesting about the past. So it gets to answer your second question. If you curate art in the past, you're looking for the ways in which artists and artworks existed in relationship to the many different kinds of time that were available in past times. Because we have a tendency when we look back in time to a past period to think that it's all one time. It's all of one time. But in fact, any period of the past has got different kinds of times and currents running through it, like through a river, different currents inside a river, and to show them out. So a documenter in that brain part, the curator showed works by Mirandi, Wonderful Still Lifes, that he did very slowly during the fascist period that hardly changed at all. Whereas right on the wall behind, she showed photographs by Lee Miller visiting Hitler's house after being in the concentration camps. She went in his bathroom. She had a bath in his bath. She stole stuff from his bathroom, a little sculpture, and she stole the makeup kit of Eva Braun, his mistress. She took them home, and we saw all of that in that documentary show, right? So, amazing. So that's what it means to curate contemporaneity as opposed to just drawing attention to anachronism, right? Does that make sense? No. Did you see that? I can actually give you an answer, a little more philosophical answer. Let me just spend a little more. So, to me, it's really about being in time, okay? Being in time. So, what we've actually got to curate is the different ways and levels and depths of being in time that, in effect, someone like Heidegger was the first person to. Well, no, he was. St. Augustine was. There have been many people, when we go back through history, who have shown us that to be in time, to actually be in the time of the world, be in the time of the body that you're in, be in the time of the gods that you believe in, if you do, to be in those times, it's a matter of layering, you know, it's a matter of projective depths, it's a matter of inversion, you know, it's a matter of sort of multiple ways of being present.
Mm-hmm.
That's just about personal, individual being in the world and the way in which objects are in the world. When we come to works of art, we're dealing with obviously things or objects that are made by people conscious of all these relationships that want to make works that bring out these relationships. when we come to curating them, the curator has a great chance to dispose objects and to dispose signs of ideas, right? Even to dispose people in spaces that manifest these different layerings of time.
Okay. Yeah, that's really good. Thank you.
Yeah, well, many of the best exhibitions that are done in the world do that. Some of them do it with enormous superficiality, like some of Jean-Hubert Martin do it with profoundly attractive but really deep superficiality. I mean, they're kind of obvious. It's an effort to escape the tensions and the frictions of this layering. So you can do it easily to make it attractive, but to really do it well in a way that attends to its depths is a huge challenge. Very rarely is it done well, I think.
Thank you very much.
Pleasure.
This question doesn't have to be as complicated.
Maybe I go now. Hello, Eric. This is Hong Jia.
Thank you. Good to see you.
Yeah, good to see you. I have two questions, and I would like to start. One is when at the beginning of the book you talk about this time space construction of an exhibition. It seems to me that you are really referring to the experience when the viewers go inside the exhibition and the experience of it. You know, but as a matter of fact, I think all the exhibition are more like a constructed site, or more like a theater in a way, because you know, it's a stage effect. You know, curator using artwork and arrange it, edit in a sequence, so it's more very a temporal and spatial feeling. Of a theater, so there's a theatricality involved. So how does this time space concept translate from a theatricality to the reality and also to the psychological effect of it? That's the first question. And second question is about when you talk about this artist as a curator and curator as an artist. I found that you're talking about this two sides, these two ideas. I'm wondering if how does it play the dialectics to each other? I'm thinking about a concrete example, for example, like 1972 when artists start to revolt against the curator situation. So the exhibition itself, a contested site. And, you know, so you get artists fighting with curator, but artists function more or less like curator in order to fight against the curator. That's my second question. And I think Xiao was like, 2.5. Okay. Just now, I think we are struggling upon this idea of contemporary. And I think maybe to curate contemporary itself is kind of an oxymoron in the sense because of, you know, as soon as we start to curate contemporary, we become post-contemporary. So the kind of a thing that I'm thinking now. That would be my two questions and 2.5 comment.
Great. Okay. So now the first one about theatre, the theatrical character of exhibitions, which I know is an idea that is fairly widespread. Many people have this idea. And in a sense, yes, because obviously a theatre, theatrical performance is time-bound and located. It's usually in one place and it takes a certain amount of time to be experienced. Right. The difference when I think of exhibitions that address that, some of them tend to be in the direction of an exhibition as so-called a theatre of the world. Right, a theatre of the world. So the world is a theatre, and I'll now show it to you. The tension is, the analogy has some tension in it, I think, because obviously in most theatrical performances, it's live theatre with humans and individuals performed in a stage set. It's usually the set that looks like the exhibition. So in other words, many exhibitions that I've seen that look theatrical are in fact exhibits of the set, not the play, if you see what I mean. And the play is performed by the spectators, but actually it isn't. The play is absent. And the spectators may move through space rather than sit through time, okay? But the play itself is not present. The play, to keep your analogy going, may be in the mind of the curator and maybe in the mind of the spectator, and maybe that's what they're composing going through the exhibition, a play, something like a play. But I wonder how far much further the analogy goes, you know. Because, you know, I mean, I think you're right that there is, that's very much part of it. But wouldn't it be wonderful to be able to define what goes on there, yes, in terms that were just curatorial, that were just to do with what the curator creates, and not an analogy to something else like a theatre? So this is what I'm trying to, I don't think I have the answers to this, but I'm trying to highlight that if curating of art of exhibitions is to be a practice in and of itself, it's not just, doesn't get its content just from showing exhibitions and then walking away. It must articulate itself in, preferably in words that I can understand. but if, I mean, it's there. It's, I mean, I know it's there and I've seen it, but it's just so hard to find it articulated. Okay. So there's my comments on your first question. The second one is on the Artist and Critic and so on and so forth. So 1972 in Sydney at the Arco New South Wales, is that what you mentioned?
Documenta, actually. Right.
Oh, Documenta 72. Ah, when I was in art language, we did the index work. Did you see that work? Are you old enough to have been there? No, you're not old enough to have gone to Documenta. Did you go to Documenta in 72?
No, I did.
No, you were born then. Yeah. So we had the art language group had a work called Index in there, and I just joined the group at that time. But you're right, that's a famous example of the curator having a set of ideas and then a group of artists led by Daniel Buren deciding that his ideas were too strong and too much in the foreground. And a group of artists, Buren, Andre, all of these, you know, Donald Judd, maybe even Solovit, I can't remember. Anyway, a group of artists refused to show their work. Right. Now, they're very famous artists subsequently. They weren't that famous at the time. It wasn't such a big deal, really. I think they made a mistake about what was going on. I mean, I think they were at that point too precious about themselves as the controllers of the spaces and the character of their work, I think, a little too precious. But on the other hand, as their work developed, each of them, particularly Don Judd, did become, like I said, a curator. I mean, Don Judd has established one of the great systems for showing minimal art. I mean, he's a more influential curator of minimal art than anyone else, any other single person on the planet, Donald Shelley. Because he's kept insisting, my work should look like this and be shown like this, and you've got to do it like that. And people just went along with it. So there are many other revolts by artists against curators that are much more interesting than 72, I think. For example, in 79 in Sydney, a group of artists, including myself and Ian Byrne and many others, objected to the exhibition, the Sydney Biennale. It had no women in it, no artists, very few Australian artists. It was just awful. Anyway, so there's lots of other ones like that. What I was trying to show in the book is there is a dialectic between the artist as curator and the curator as artist, and it's gradually resolved itself in the work of many artists in a way that's almost set the tone. It's become pervasive, particularly in Europe and America. It's really pervasive within that. So within the first current, and some of the artists who come from the third current. So if you really wanted me to lay it out in terms of my framework, I think it's become the interzone between the first current and the third current, right? In world art. I don't think it operates particularly as strongly on the second current level, because in a curious way, within decolonization and so on and so forth, there is artists and curators understand they have distinct roles, which in the end they do. Right? So, as I say somewhere in the book, when an artist curates an exhibition fully, he or she is acting as a curator. Mm-hmm. When a curator makes an exhibition fully like an artist, he or she has made a work of art.
Yeah.
Right? In between, there's a lot of interaction and shifting and modelling. But either end is still different. They're like criticism and history is different. But it's paradoxical because the way in which all of these disciplines and practices change, I think, is by adopting the techniques or values of the one next to them, the adjacent one. So the best art historians are the best art critics. And vice versa. But they're not wholly art critics and not entirely art historians, So similarly. Anyway, the third one. Okay, the third one is also very interesting. Second and a half question. Very interesting.
Postcode.
Because if you curate contemporaneity in a totally self-conscious way, as if, oh, I'm going to do an exhibition that shows contemporaneity, it's like creating a map of the world the same size as the world. And if you do it and succeed, you'll end up, you won't be post-contemporary, you'll just be really boring, it'll just be too mechanical, it'll just be too much like the world is, It's when I say curate contemporaneity, I mean open yourself to all the forces and the contradictions and the energies of the contemporaneous world, all the frictions, all the antinomies, all the struggles. Let them impact on you, and the impact will in effect, you'll end up showing them, or at least some of them, in your exhibition, which is what Documenta does. So Carol and Christoph McCarthy have been current documented. In my view, she deliberately said, I've got no idea, I've got no single thought that is going to put, a line or a shape around the whole world. But I'm going to show a series of impacts of the world on artworks from various parts of the world. I mean, quite literally, some artworks are there because they were bombed, and some because they were stolen, and some because they were distorted, right? And so it's an exhibition about contemporaneity and different ways of being in time But it doesn't say, this is the whole story, you know, this is everything. It just says, look at these particular sets of impacts. I mean, finally, I'll just say, in this sense, curating is like artworks. You can't, if you set out to make an artwork that's going to go into current number one, or current number two, or number three, or if you set out to be entirely contemporary as an artist, that's your goal as an artist, you are going to produce crap. You'll produce bad art. I mean, these are not artistic intentions or goals. These are descriptions that critics and historians and curators bring to art after it is made. Okay? So, just to be clear, I'm just trying to analyze and understand what's going on. Not have a, so, does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much for your kind answer.
Okay, good question. Yeah, great.
Yeah, now we have an expert.
Hi, Mr. Smith. My name's Ken.
Hey.
So I have a very simple question for you, and this is somewhat related to curating contemporaneity. So what do you think should be the proper response of biennials in terms of curating contemporaneity, especially in the context of the biennial is not having the ability to turn itself and create self-reflexive exhibitions that continuously question the foundation on which it exists. So my question is, it's related to this notion of probably biennial bashing, the idea that they always tend to provoke but never nourish. What do you think should be the proper response in terms of, like, you know, making it a perfect institution for creating dialogue, probably?
Okay. So somewhere in the book I've got a passage where I basically say that the whole challenge that a lot of curators now impose upon themselves to change the biennial every time you do a biennial, okay, to fundamentally change what an exhibition is every time you make one, but that's, in a way, that's a sort of, it's to mistake the biennial form for why you're doing that exhibition in this place at that time. Okay. So I think that maybe we've got to a point where the biennials become so frequent and so institutionalized and appears in so many places that there's a kind of presumption that every one of them is the same and the same kind of exhibition, serving the same kind of purpose, just because it happens every 2 years and lasts for a few months. That doesn't make it the same kind of exhibition in the same kind of place. Because, as I've said, I think I said an earlier point, the biennial form is fantastically useful, particularly for art from what I call second current. There's a reason why New York doesn't have one and Paris has one, but it doesn't work, they don't really need it. London doesn't have one. I mean, there's a reason why the great centres in the world don't have them. They don't need them because they've constantly got exhibitions that show you contemporary art, show you the transformations of the infrastructure, give you all these alternatives. You don't need an annual, a biannual summary of what the art of the world is like. Okay, second thing, we're from Pittsburgh, and so the second biennial in the world was the Carnegie International that started in 1896, a few months later after Venice. But it developed in a very different way. And the fundamental reason is that, I think, that Venice stopped changing. I mean, the reason why the Venice Biennale works is that the rest of the city stays old. I mean, it stays a museum. And every 2 years, a group of people bring contemporary art, contemporary life to Venice. Right? And then next year they'll bring film, and next year they'll bring architecture. So Venice is this amazingly anachronistic. So we go back to Shao. Venice is a living museum of anachronism. There's an example. Venice will never become contemporary. There's no contemporaneity in Venice, okay? They just bring in these international festivals to try and connect with the rest of the world. But for the rest of the time, they perform this museum of the past. And that's what makes it really attractive, because there's a great contradiction to live. As long as you don't have to live your whole life that way, if you live it just for a few months or a week or so every year, every 2 years, that's fun. Now, in Pittsburgh, it has a different kind of history. It was a very modernizing city and didn't have much art, needed the art, what Andrew Kinney said, the best art from the world to come to Pittsburgh. And every year he was going to buy one painting and then have a museum starting in 1986, coming up to the present, with one new work added every year. So you've got this panorama of the best work of art made every year from that point on, right? And then it became every second year because they buy works from every year. So if you come to Pittsburgh and actually see the history of art every 2 years going like that, it's ridiculous. You know, it's just crazy. So anyway, I could go on for hours about it, but the essential point is that the biennial form in and of itself is not going to have a solution that will be true for every biennial everywhere in the world. That's a category mistake. You wouldn't, for example, say, oh, well, the perfect temporary exhibition in a museum has to be like X, Y, and Z. You'd never say that. Why would anyone say that? The perfect temporary exhibition has to be different from the one before, right? The perfect museum, you know, you can't list the characteristics of a perfect museum. So it's a logical error to try and perfect the Biennale by any means. You understand? So that's how I would answer that question. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Pleasure.
So, hello, Professor Heather Smith. This is Chu Zijie. My question is, as you already got my map, my question is, do you think this is a type of over-curating? Because I'm actually not sure about that. I have put the map all over the exhibition, everywhere in the catalog. You can got one map everywhere. The map as well, and also in the show, I put the map as well. I make a series of map. And I'm actually not sure, is it a kind of over-curating? As an artist, I always waiting for a strong, a powerful curator. And, you know, if a curator comes with me, without, yes. As an artist, normally I'm waiting for the powerful idea from a curator, like I can actually work with that concept. And if the curator comes to me without any like a strong idea, I will disappoint. But as a curator, when I do that with a map, send it to all the artists, put it to the catalog. Actually, I'm not sure about these kinds of over-curating. And, you know, it is a type of, as you talk, this place making and this work picturing and connectivity. Yeah. I think it's quite about mapping. But I'm not sure.
Well,
for you.
So I didn't quite get the question. Did you make a question here?
Yes. So my question is for you. Do you think to use the map as the base of the whole Biennale, it is kind of over-curating of too much powerful as a curator?
No. The short answer is no. Because I don't...
Okay. Okay, I have
so
a...
Cu- can I just say a little bit? I don't think curators have that kind of power. What was that, Kate? What did she say?
Give Chijijie the longer answer as well.
Okay. Because the map, well, your map, I was very, because your map, in a way, when I first looked at it, reminded me of the sort of maps that they drew in the 19th century for setting up industrial plants in places like Pittsburgh or Germany or so on. And then I looked more closely, and I see it's also a body, relates to a body, idea of a body. And then I got the map and I put it on my big screen, and I put next to the map, I downloaded maps of China, and I tried to see whether you were drawing a map of China. And maybe you were, I think so. But then I looked more closely, and it's actually Shanghai and Hangzhou. I mean, it looks more close, it looks like it's more the region that you're in, I think. Is that right? Is that correct? So the city or the area underneath the map is the Shanghai region, or is it China as a whole? Or is it anywhere, speculative place? No? Yes?
Yes, It's actually the system of a power plant, of a power station, of a factory. Yeah, yeah, how a power station factory works.
Yeah. Okay.
Of course, so, I miss with some like a body system, with some like organic body system. I miss them. Actually, I have some comment when we talk about this. My second question, maybe not a question, is about this spectator. We know this Shanghai Biennale is in a double history. It's part of the so-called international curatorial plastic, but also it is in the process of Chinese social transformation. And you know, it's very clearly we don't even have a really work art museum. So it's not the time for a Shanghai contemporary art museum to think about, like, to imagine. We are imagining a museum like a well-done museum, but it's not yet. So when we write about the shell history of Shanghai Biennale, this history writing is actually still very political. I can remember in the end of last year, we tried to public the first newsletter. And I talk about the Shanghai Biennale's history of last editions. And the artistic committee's chairman, Mr. Xu Jiang, he adds something beautiful word in front of my sentence. And he said, if we don't say Shanghai Biennale is good, nobody will say it is in the Chinese society. So that means we still have too many too many power against the Shanghai Biennale and against a contemporary art museum. So a regular Biennale and regular museum, contemporary art museum itself, is still some very, very political elements in China here now. To build a like a regular Biennale, how much budget you have? And do you have international curators and a number of international artists? All of these things is still very political. So in this situation, in this context, historical context,
we can say sometimes to bring something special, it's also part of this political process. For example, I have to show something like Huang Yongping piece. We said, yeah, big and spectacle in a big lobby. Only when I did that, I can show this Pittsburgh piece in the city pavilions. It's kind of, yeah.
Buy one, get one. You should.
And if you see in the lobby or the Biennale, you got this like old ladies, like 60 years old ladies. They like this Huang Yongping, they like this spectacle piece.
Yeah.
And So you got like a quite different context. Like what I mean is, you know, we are in a two different contexts.
Yes.
In one side, we know the museum is not the only way to produce art, but on the other hand, still the museum is one of the most important public space in China, which is full of political meaning. The Biennale itself, some spectacle work, and to fill the big lobby of the PSA Museum and this power station of art museum itself to exist here in China nowadays is something very political. It became types of so-called the system activity.
Infrastructural activism.
Yeah.
And like, that's why I can contribute something special from this Shanghai Biennale, because I think it is actually quite typical for what we are thinking. You know, we have artists as the curator, and we have also this year the museum as the biggest sculpture in the world. And actually got it from the museum.
Great, that sounds good. Hang on. Okay, thank you. Well, that gives me a picture of why the Shanghai Biennale is so important in Shanghai. Because in every part of the world, like I said to the young man before you, the Biennale means something different depending on what other infrastructure is there, what the political climate is like. And the Biennale has the Biennales, particularly in your country, in Australia, South America, many parts of the world, they have the great advantage of being experimental zones, right? It's a zone of experimentation where you can try out what a museum might look like if it was a truly international, truly questioning, truly political, truly critical space. This is the kind of thing that you could do in this city. So the great thing about, I mean, you can't do that in a temporary exhibition, or you can do it to a degree maybe, but with a biennial, and particularly because a biennial has to account, has to be responsible not only to its own city, has to be responsible to the rest of the world, to other cities. So it's not just people visit it. You have to make an exhibition that will have an impact in other cities. Right? It doesn't have to change the whole world, but it should show that from this city, the city can sustain a perception of the world and a kind of critical, reflexive self-consciousness to a degree that adds to those qualities of kind of, you know, freedom and independent critical consciousness that the world as a whole needs, right? This is just very important thing. So because Biennale is both local and international, is responsible in both directions. Yeah. So it's a big challenge for a curator to succeed in facing inwards and outwards, and to be kind of critical and independent in both directions. It's very hard to do that well. I think maybe only, I've seen maybe, I can't remember, at least 100 Biennales by now. And I would think maybe only 10 or so would do that. It's hard. So I wished I was there, and I wish I could see your Biennale. Then maybe I could say whether I thought it did that.
It's my deal here.
Okay.
So for you to consider this so-called international Biennale of visitors, it's still like we still need to consider this like a certain group of people. You know, we already have a group of people which is international professional Biennale of visitors, and you know we had to face to these local people, but on the other hand, to answer these professional people, international travel like Ed and Bande, to face to these people, it's still like necessary for a local Biennale curator.
Yeah, that's true. But the local audiences, you're gradually, it's not just the Biennale, but all the other things you do in the city, the other structures. It's just a matter of gradually building up their, if you like, their literacy, their ability to read an exhibition and to understand what art is about and what it can be about. It takes many years, it takes decades to build up a kind of culture of spectatorship that isn't just superficial and, you know, isn't ordinary. It takes a long while. It happens differently in every country. And often you have to do exhibitions that will, you know, maybe offend local people or not interest local people. But in, as you know, amongst the people you speak to in Shanghai, there'll be a whole range of opinions and a whole range of understandings. Some will be able to grasp the exhibition. Some will get it next time. See, that's another thing about Biennales is that every time I go to one in a particular city, the one before, 2 years ago, looks much better than it did when I visited it. It's a really strange thing, because now Biennales have been going on for so long that they're accumulating a kind of local history. You know, so I remember how much better this space looked when it had this other work of art in it 2 years ago. And you know, all times anyway. Yes. So
that's like all times when old are good. If our times pass by, and people were said this, that is a golden time.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure. Okay, how are we doing?
Yes.
Okay.
Terry, I know that you're tired because it's now past midnight for you.
Oh, it is 12:14 a.m. I'm usually in bed by now.
Exactly. So I just want to push you on one thing, because I think it's important, because this afternoon we're critiquing the Shanghai Biennial, and all the participants are coming up with their biennial proposal, because they're all of them have potential to curate the next biennial.
Okay.
In the next
day.
So the question that Chijijie was asking you earlier was, with the map, the main criticism he has received is that the map appears everywhere. It's in the catalogue, it's throughout the exhibition space, i.e. the way in which, because he hasn't written a catalogue essay, the map is kind of the process, the description, the proposal for how the exhibition will be.
Right.
It's the thinking. So he was asking, is it too much? Is it over-curating to constantly reiterate the kind of beginning idea throughout the exhibition? And I just wanted to push you to give a longer response to that, because I think it will be important this afternoon.
Okay.
So imagine that, like super... I don't know if you can...
So So my answer is in principle, no.
Okay.
I don't know, because I think curators should be clear, as I keep saying, renounce reticence, curate reflexively, articulate curatorial thinking, you know, be clear about it. It's not as if the curating is natural or comes from the ground, you know, or grows like a tree. It's a conscious, critical thought about activity. So if you thought about it to the extent of coming up with this amazing diagram, you know, that I've got here, I've got a picture of it right here. If you thought about it that much, you should be clear about it. So that's I'm quite cool about that. So the maybe people objecting less to this as an idea because it's not. I mean, to me, it doesn't have the character of a set of rules. I mean, it looks like a speculative dream. It looks like a kind of fantasy about how the thing might work. It doesn't look like a rigid diagram that you have to go to this place and that place and the other place. It looks more like a dreamscape, you know, in a way. Even though it's a power plant, it's a fantasy. You know, no power plant looks like this, you know, in practice. So my question would be that maybe people think that they have been given a layout and that the physical distribution of buildings in Shanghai is somehow like this, and if you went from one to the other, you'd get that. I'm not clear. I don't know whether that's the case. Is that the case, Kate?
Is it that people think that they can go from this place to this place to this place in the city? Is that one of the criticisms, that they are reading this map as where to go to?
Yeah, I think we have the bad, you know, if we got the... I think when we got the map, a city visitor, he got the map in the Shanghai railway station of Shanghai City. But we still have the good map user and the bad map user. And the clever map user always actually create his own map on this city. And he adds some detail on the map, and he discovers new and adds it on the map. And the bad map matter will become the staff on the map. So I think the map itself is nothing, but it's quite about how people use it, the way people use it. It's quite about. And for me, I'm actually trying to call people to make their out of my joy, and that I also get the notes on the notes on. I said actually more map, more important map is in your mind, it's in the mind of the readers. So I hope the people can produce, can develop their own map out of my adventure. That's the idea.
Okay, great. Good luck.
So I want to say thank you, and we're going to give you a big round of applause right now.
Oh, thank you. All right, thanks very much. It's great fun. All right, and, good luck, Kate. Have a good time there. Okay, cheers.
Okay.